Hello everyone. Welcome to Moodle Academy webinar on assessment. Today we are going to explore the gradebook. And the link here guides you to the relevant course in Moodle Academy. Well, of course you know it since you already come from that. The content of the course will be revealed after the webinar. I am Anna Krasa, Education Advisor in Moodle Academy, and I'm joined by Mary Kutch, our famous Education Manager.
Hello.
So let's start by giving a quick overview of the assessment in Moodle, because grades and gradebook is what we are going to talk about today. You might already know that Moodle can support different assessment methods, different grading methods, and has several types of activities to support assessment. It has activities that can be automatically assessed, has activities where a teacher needs to assess, and activities that are or can be set up for peer assessment. In Moodle, there are also two grading methods, the simple direct grading method and the advanced grading. In the first, the grading can be done through points, like numerical scales, and also grading can also be done with descriptive scales, like pass-fail, incomplete, adequate, complete, or five-star scale. Depending on the needs of our course, we might also set up an activity with no grading at all. When we use the advanced grading methods, we can also assess activities either by a grading rubric or a marking guide. As mentioned before, Moodle has several activities that can be used for grading. These activities, there are activities that require human grading, that need to be graded by the teacher. And these are the assignment, the forum, the glossary, the database, and the workshop. And the automatically graded or system graded activities like the quiz, the lesson, the S5P, and scores. Assignments and, excuse me, I'm moving on. All these grades end up into the gradebook. The Moodle Gradebook is a very powerful tool because it collects all the activity grades in one place, from where teachers can do some magic. We will see that magic in a while. A gradebook should be seen as the tool that completes the instructional design process, as it is a tool that implements the assessment strategy for an online course. It serves as the central hub for all student grades in a course, while it gives learners real-time access to their grades and feedback for all the course-graded activities. And of course, for teachers, it gives them access into a consolidated grade report of learners' achievements. So here we have a screenshot of the gradebook from a student's point of view, and I would like to drag your attention to the fact that usually activities create one grading item in the gradebook, unless if the activity is graded in two ways. For example, in this screenshot, I have highlighted the two grading items that are automatically created for the workshop activity. For those who are not aware, workshop activity supports peer assessment along with teacher assessment. So the first grading item is for the submission that will be assessed by the teacher. And the second one is for the peer assessment process. Something similar happens with a form activity too. This also can support both post ratings and whole forum grading. And consequently, this will create two grading items into the gradebook. Now, here we can see things from a teacher's point of view. And specifically, we can see the grade report, which is the main page of the gradebook for teachers. From here, they can see all users and all activities. The table here is fully adjustable, as columns can be collapsed, the users can be filtered and sorted. Teachers can also turn editing on here, and they can assess learners directly through the gradebook, although personally I wouldn't recommend that. I wouldn't recommend that because when teachers edit grades directly from the gradebook, they actually override the grades that come from the activity. Sometimes teachers prefer that. But my personal experience wasn't that nice, because often teachers were accidentally overriding through the grade report the grades that should automatically update it from the activity. And that was creating confusion. Now, through the gradebook, and specifically from the gradebook setup that we will see a lot moving forward, teachers have the ability to add a grading item, store grades that are not linked to an activity from the course. And I would like to ask you, have you ever assessed via the grade report? To be honest, it's been years for me since the last time I saw facilitators assessing through the grade report. It sounds to me like a very old-fashioned way of assessment. But what's your experience? Would you like to share your thoughts in the chat?
Yes, do type in the chat if you have any comments to make, and I can read it out to Anna. I suppose if you create a specific grade item, you would assess it, you would edit it in the grader report. But I think you made a very good point earlier about not doing that. For instance, if it's an assignment, where you'd assess directly in the assignment.
Have you ever assessed through the gradebook, Mary? You've been teacher for ages.
No, I tend to assess in assignments. For example, we do have some others here. Catherine, we only edit the grades in the grader report if the original mark has to be overridden, for example, due to academic misconduct. Inigo says, I've never done it, but I've often seen teachers doing it. Okay. What I used to do when I was a teacher, for example, using Moodle, was that if there was a task that was done outside of Moodle, I would still create an assignment as an offline assignment and grade in the assignment, not make something and grade in the grader report. Doug Ray says, yes, in many of my courses, skipping an assignment results in a zero score. I've sometimes added zeros. I've also applied late penalties and academic misconduct cases. But Tina says, again, I agree, it's better not to assess students using the grade report. Only use this when you have to. It helps you identify when the grade was purposely changed. As Pajamak, I hope I've said that right, the need to override, yes. Any special cases when you want to freeze a score? And again, Hiroshini says, yeah, I had to manually enter the marks for offline activities, but I preferred, as I said, to use assignments, even though they didn't have to submit anything. So let's go back to you then. Anna, we've got lots of feedback there.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. So I would like us to ask you a quick question. Rather than typing in the chat, let's take a poll. Okay, it's coming. Tell us, how important do you consider the gradebook in your courses? Is it absolutely essential? It's pretty important. It's okay, I guess. Not really a big deal. Or who even uses it? Okay, I can see the percentages coming. Okay, we are 91% participated. Yep. Okay, 93. So I'm ending the poll and sharing the results. Give me a second to show you the results. Can you see?
I can see. Yes, people can see in the chat as well. So we've got 44% absolutely essential and 38% pretty important. So, yep. And then 16%, it's okay, I guess.
Perfect. So let me go back to the presentation and stop sharing this. We will come back later into more polls, basically. But now, excuse me. Okay, after the poll, we are here. I think we all agreed that the gradebook is important. And it is important because basically it carries out the assessment strategy of an online course. The assessment strategy is the one that ensures that the activities are aligned with the course learning outcomes, providing a clear pathway for students to demonstrate their understanding and their progress. So in order to end up to the gradebook and use it in a meaningful way, we need to begin with the instructional design of a course. Of course, we won't go through the whole process of the instructional design. We have other courses for that in Moodle Academy, but we will only focus on the aim, the learning outcomes, and the course activities. And we will completely skip the content of the course. So let's see specifically, we have an example of a personal development course. The aim of the course is to help learners build their self-awareness and reflection, cultivate their emotional intelligence and resilience, and build their skills on effective goal setting and planning. And on the side, you can see the learning outcomes. Students will be able to identify their own value, strengths, and weaknesses, recognize the impact of emotion, thoughts, and behaviors on their lives, recognize and manage their own emotions in a healthy way, including developing self-care habits and stress management techniques, and create a personalized plan for achieving their goals, including strategies for overcoming obstacles and staying motivated. Now, in order to help learners learn and give them the chance to apply the new knowledge acquired, the teacher has also developed four activities. Each of the activities corresponds directly to one of the learning outcomes. In the course that accompanies this webinar, you will find more detailed description of the activities, the description, the settings, and etc. And of course, in the course, you can also see those activities built under the demo section. Of course, they are exemplar activities, and you don't need them to complete them in order to complete the course. But let's get back to our personal development assessment strategy. Here we have one assignment that will be graded with a custom scale, good, great, excellent. A forum to be graded with another custom scale, developing excellent effort, well done. A lesson that is assessed on a 0-10 scale. An assignment that is assessed on a 0-100 scale. So as soon as you develop this activity, these elements, the grading items, will be recorded into the grades. In this table, we only see the activities and their grades. But by defining the aggregation method, you will determine how the individual grades will be combined and calculated into a final grade for students. These methods allow instructors to apply different rules and weightings to grade items, ensuring that the final grade accurately reflects the intended assessment strategy. So let's take a breath and let us know if you have any queries so far and if this instructional design process is familiar to you or not. I understand that probably experienced educators tend to do things more intuitively, like getting into the course and start building things without a lot of thinking around of the details of grading and stuff like that. Let us know, what's your practice?
While people are writing, I hope we get some more good feedback here. I do like using custom scales, although I know that some teachers are unaware that just as with numerical scales go 0 to 100, with custom scales, you have to remember to put the lowest word that you want first, as you did in yours, good, very good, excellent, or so on. Otherwise, it grades completely in the opposite way. This is Prajamek said, clever, that in the scales you proposed, the first step is not a zero like units. Aggregation is very, very interesting and something that I personally struggle with, and I'm looking forward to this presentation. Doug says, a good point. Often the structure of the grading is dictated by the employer, which might be your university. And Maria says, I tend to use scales that are not different from each other. Martina likes rubrics, and we're going to cover these. And Kat says, we tend to use the numerical, so the points out of 100. Tina makes the point that although custom scales are great, they've got to be prepared and agreed by the educational institutions. And Liliana says, in aviation, we must use percentages to classify the results. So we've got a wide spectrum of different uses there. Thank you, everybody.
That's really interesting. So let's move on to see how the assessment strategy applies into the gradebook. Basically, it's mainly applied by defining the aggregation method. Aggregation methods are crucial because they influence how grades are interpreted and how the final course grade is calculated. Selecting the right aggregation method ensures that student performance is evaluated fairly and consistently, aligning with the course learning objectives and assessment philosophy. But in order to understand aggregations, we need to clarify two things: scales and weights. In Moodle, a grading scale is a set of values used to evaluate student performance, such as the numerical scales, 0, 10, for example, or the later grade A to F, or descriptive scales, pass, fail, or good, average, excellent. Now, the weight refers to the relative importance of a grade item within the overall course grade, determining how much it contributes to the final grade calculation when using aggregation methods like weighted and mean grades or natural. Aggregation methods, weights, and more are controlled by the gradebook setup. If you just go into the grades, you will see the grade report is a drop-down menu, and you can select the gradebook setup. Of course, only available for teachers, right? So let's move on to the second poll. Just to give us some feedback. And tell us, have you ever used a custom scale in your course? So how familiar are you with that? Because we are going to dig really deep with this. Well, for those who haven't used the custom scales, be aware that as a teacher with editing rights in a Moodle course, you can go into the grades and from that menu, so previously, you can set up a descriptive custom scale, like needs improvement, good try, well done. And instead of using a numerical scale like 0 to 100, you can use a descriptive scale. And sometimes it's more convenient. It might be more appropriate. You can set it up to be funny, or you can set it up to be only positive, good, great, excellent. Like, it depends your students, and it depends what you are trying to do. You may just create a custom scale for giving a quick feedback and a reward for people with smiley something. Now I'm gonna share the results. It's interesting. It seems that most of you have used the custom reports. That's nice. And we are ready. Did you see? Sorry. Do you see the polls?
I see the results. Yes, I see we've got mostly 41% saying sometimes, yes, 20% saying many times, and 11% saying never. So yeah, we've got a good amount there.
Yep, and let's move on. Let's move on to see the aggregation methods. And we can start with the natural aggregation. This is the default setup in Moodle. And in recent Moodle versions, a natural aggregation includes scales, where the first level counts as 1 point, not as a zero. And it automatically calculates the weights according to the max score of the scale used. So if you give to important activities a higher scale, like 0 to 100, and into less important activities, lower scales, like 0 to 10, then natural aggregation suits your needs. Following our example, the gradebook from the teacher's point of view, the example of personal development course, you can see here that the custom scales count with 3 levels and the weights are automatically awarded by the system, calculated up to the maximum grades. In that case, students will be seeing that. I would like to highlight that highlight the course, the contribution to the course total. In this natural aggregation, with the default setup of weights, the contribution to course total is 1.72% for the first activity that is assessed with the custom scale. Just keep that in your mind. Let's move on and see the natural aggregation without the scales, excluding the scales. In fact, in older Moodle versions, the natural aggregation didn't include scales. So now it's up to system administrators to decide if they want scales to be included in the aggregation or not. So this is more like a managerial decision for your organization. Here we're going to see an example of excluding grades, and the two activities with the custom scales are completely ignored in the aggregation, and system automatically calculates the weights according to the maximum score of the scale used. So seeing things from a pedagogical perspective, it's clear that in this case, the first two activities, although they are considered to be important steps in the learning process, they are not contributing to the course total, giving more value to the last two activities. They are important and they are graded through the activities, but they are not contributing at all to the course total. So in other words, we could say that the first two activities are used more as formative assessment to help learners learn, and the last two for summative, to actually evaluate learners' new knowledge. And things are getting more clear if we see things from the student point of view. You can see here that the calculated way makes clear to the students that these two activities are not contributing to the course total. Then there is a third variation of natural aggregation, which is one that include scales are included, but also we can apply custom weights. So if you consider as a teacher that the first assignment is important as it sets the base for the whole learning process, it could weight something like the 1/3 of the total score, for example, 30%. Then the middle two activities are mostly formative, but you want to give them some value in order to maintain learners' interest and reward them for their effort. So together they worth something like 1/5 of the course total, let's say 20%. And the final assignment is the most important one, as it encapsulates the knowledge from all the course, and it's worth like the half of the course total. You may give it 50% away. And you can set up the grades, the grades by overriding the weights, as in the example here. You just need to tick the boxes of weights and type the weights you want to be applied. By customizing the weights in the aggregation, we control the value of each item towards the course total. So now the first activity for our student contributes 20% of the course total. And here, the adaptation of scales follow the concept that we have three grading levels that were 30% of the course, and each level worth 10%. So the grade, which is the grade, which is the score for this activity for our student, worth 20%. Let's move on to another aggregation method, the mean of grades. Here we have no weights applied. The scale levels are interpreted differently, as they start from zero rather than one, as in natural. And now, as a teacher, you can assume that we'll assume that you have chosen the grading scales based on what fits best in each activity and your students, and you believe that the course total should be built gradually by completing different activities of the same value. If that's the case, this assessment method would be the easiest for you to use, as you don't need to make any adjustment. This is the teacher point of view, but things are much clearer when seeing from students' point of view. You can see here that all the weights are equal and have been automatically awarded. And you can also note that the course total adjusts up to 100. It's not like the natural. Here, the concept applied for the interpretation of the custom scales is different. The score grade is the 50% of the percentage of the 20% of the weight. So good worth 0%, great 12.5%, and excellent 25%. These are the tricky bits of how natural and how mean of grades are interpreting differently the custom scales. The last method that we will see today is the weighted mean of grades. And it's, again, one of the old aggregation type. The mean of grades and the weighted mean of grades exist in Moodle since, I think, forever. And while the natural grading has been, aggregation has been introduced in more recent versions. So in the weighted mean of grades, things are quite similar to the natural, including scales with custom weighting, but there are two main differences. The scale starts from zero again, and the course total is also aggregated up to 100. Here, teachers need to define the weight of each activity. And here is the student point of view. Note that here, although the three grading levels worth 30% of the course, the grade is considered to be again the 50% of 30%, which is the weight. Time for maths. So, how do you feel with maths? Is gradebook anyhow deciphered for you, or I've just made things worse? Say your thoughts in the chat. Mary, how do you feel?
Well, you definitely no, you haven't made things worse. I particularly appreciated the explanations about the aggregation and the relevance of the zero. We do have a few comments on various parts of the presentation here. There was some discussion about scales, for instance. Jamek saying maybe it would be better if teachers could decide if scales contribute to the course total or not, rather than it being an admin setting. Doug also makes a valid point. You should use scales with smaller numbers of steps. I think you mean more words in the scale when there's no way to meaningfully distinguish between neighboring scores. If you just got two, for instance, incompetent, competent, you couldn't really distinguish between a lower score and a slightly less lower score. Also, Pajamek, I personally pay the greatest attention to the relative values of the maximum grades. So having activities worth 10 points versus those scoring up
Message
to 100 makes a real difference in terms of, he says, there's almost no point in using weights, basically. But yeah, has anyone, has anything been clarified for you?
Let's see. Moving on,
Ooh.
We have another quick poll. Just let us know which is the aggregation method that feels right to you. Consider your courses and your audience. So it's the natural with scales, it's the natural without scales, it's the natural with custom weights, it's the mean of grades or the weighted mean of grades.
And while you're voting, just reading a comment from Hiroshini saying, I actually didn't have a clear idea how weighting works in different aggregation methods. And now my doubts have been clarified, cleared, which is really useful.
Glad.
And I'm also watching the votes and, you know, there's quite a mix, actually.
Yes. To be honest, since Moodle 1.9, the weighted mean of grades has been my favorite aggregation method because it was easy for me to understand the concept, basically. So when I had I could control the value and the aggregation by playing with the weights rather than need to consider and carefully do the maths based on the scales. So I was using any kind of scales I wanted. And at the end, I was adjusting the weights in the way I wanted. So I didn't paid much attention on the scales. I mean, I wasn't thinking the scales as part of the assessment. I had the final decision through the weights. And I see that...
We do seem to have comments in the chat where people are justifying their preference for weighted mean of grades, actually, interestingly. Several people feeling that that one is the better one or the easiest one to use. And
do you
flexible.
Think it's because it aggregates up to 100? Because for me, that's I don't know. It's kind of a disorder to have a course total that goes beyond 100.
I understand that Americans do like grades above 100 for some reason. I think they like superlatives. Doug makes a point here, says often I must use weighted means because of university grade rules. And sometimes you are restricted by your organization's policies.
Definitely. Okay. Let me share the results. Can you see?
Yes.
So... we have
a clear winner.
Yeah. Weighted mean of grades. Yes, a clear winner, 44%. That's wow. And also, well, we also have the natural with custom weights going up to 42%. So that's really, really, really interesting. Thank you. Let's move on. And let's do something easier. Let's discuss something easier than calculations. Here we're going to see three tips or tricks, as you prefer, of the gradebook. Things that worked. You have noticed probably that the course development is not always a neat and ordered process. Sometimes an activity is not created, the activities are not created following the logical order. Often we start drafting an activity and then we have an idea, we add an activity before that, and then we add a couple later, and then we go back again, and all this up and down, and this messed way of creating course, which is absolutely normal, creates confusion in the when you compare the course, the order of the activities in the course and the order of the activities in the gradebook. You need to keep in mind that the activities are listed in the gradebook in the order they are created, not in the order that they are placed inside the course. So consider, though, that your learners, if you have this messy development, course development process like me, consider to take a look into the gradebook setup and put things in order, because your students might be confused with a messy thing. Another tip is to exclude the empty grades or not. Well, the exclude empty grades option determines how Moodle handles activity that have not been graded yet. This is an option that you can find in the grade category settings. If this option is enabled, Moodle will ignore any grade item that has no grade when calculating the category or course total. If it is disabled, unticked, Moodle will treat empty grades as zero when calculating average of totals. And here is an example. With exclude empty grades disabled, students' averages are based only on the work they have completed and have been graded for. So this is often used to give students the benefit of the doubt until all grades are in, encouraging participation without penalizing them for grades that haven't been entered yet. With exclude empty grades enabled, any ungraded work is assumed to be a zero. This might be used to show students the impact of a missing work on the overall grade. And this can be a motivator for students to submit all the assignments. The point is that there's no right or wrong here. It depends on your audience. It depends on your teaching method. In any case, what you need to do is to clearly communicate the assessment strategy to your learners so they are aware. And the third trick here is how to deal with long graded reports. Some courses may contain multiple graded activities. I've seen courses with dozens of quizzes, and not all of them are counting to the course total. Some of them may be just there for formative assessment, just for helping learners learn. And they might not have real value in as a graded items. So in these cases, instead of having a very long graded report, which, of course, you can scroll up and down and it you have frozen the name of participants and the name of the activities, but still it's not very, very helpful. If you prefer a more neat layout like me, you may consider to group these activities in grade categories. You can create a category from the gradebook setup, and add the category, and then move all the items you want to group them together into that category. So in the grade report, you will have the option to just display the total instead of having multiple columns for all these. So tell us in the chat, what's your tip?
Yes.
Do you have any?
Gradebook tips, please. I don't have any gradebook tips because I rely on Anna for helping me with the gradebook. There might be a little query about one of the slides that perhaps we can check afterwards. The example about exclude empty grades, the 80 should be 85 possibly. Maybe we want to look at that later.
Yeah. I'll take it.
Yes. And then because this is a good reminder, actually, that we will share the presentation and we'll also share the recording later on after the end of this webinar so everyone can benefit.
Perhaps. The recording will take
a bit longer. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. But it will come. It will come. Yes. Jenna says, I use categories, subcategories, and sometimes subcategories, depending on the size and complexity of the course. I feel this is important for the students' visual. Mm-hmm. Pajamek says, adding missing zeros for unsubmitted, missed assignments, etc. Another important point on the teacher's agenda, it can't be automated, unfortunately. Catherine says, I like adding categories to handle assignments and their resits, then using the highest grade to ignore an earlier failure. Okay. Oh, now Manfred, we haven't mentioned this yet. Manfred exports the gradebook into Excel and finds it much easier to use there to mark, move, color, and summarize something using Excel, the features of Excel.
Well, that was a very good comment. I used to export also the gradebook, not to grade, but in order to send these as reports into line managers in a corporate environment where the managers were carefully monitoring the learning of the employees, and it was really helpful to be able to have this export. But nice tip. Yeah, next time.
And just one last thing, Pajamek says extra credit can be a useful option with items and entire categories even. Okay, then we're moving on.
Yep, I think Gradebook is like an endless pool of things. We have limited things here for this webinar, and we are almost reaching the hour. And this is the last but not least that we are going to discuss today, is the fact that we shouldn't forget that the gradebook is a tool that should be helping learners in the learning journey. So let's decode learners' view. What its column mean? Let's see things one by one. The first thing, it's very clear. The first column is the grade item, and it has the activity name and the link. The second one is the calculated way. This is either manually set by the teacher or automatically adjusted by the system. The weight of each activity shows how much it contributes to the course total. The third column is the grade, which is the actual grade that has been awarded to the learner. The fourth is the range. It displays the minimum and maximum grades of the scale. The fifth column is the percentage that shows the percentage of the grade given comparing to the specific range. It means how well did the learner score in that particular activity. The rank is the position of the learner among their peers. So here we can see that Anna student is the first among the other four in her class. The feedback is the feedback that has been given to the learner for the activity. And the final one, the eighth one, is the contribution to course total. This is the percentage calculated for the learner's grade for the course total. And it's a percentage that is affected by the, is defined by the aggregation method. Of course, we don't have to use them, all this information. For example, if you are in a primary school, young learners won't benefit from all this information. They won't even understand that. So you can simplify things. And perhaps you can completely remove the grades and leave just the feedback for them. It's super easy. It will still give them a clear overview of their progress inside the course. In a competitive learning environment, though, with adult learners, you might want to use the rank. You may want to use the calculated weight that explains the importance of each activity and how they can lead the way. And perhaps the percentage is not that important, so as the contribution to the total. So you can play with all these options. And of course, all these settings can be controlled by the course grade setting user report. So which column do you display in the user grade report? Do you actually, tell us in the chat, do you actually edit the view of the learners, or it is just set up somehow from your administrator and it follows that?
Yes, let us know what you do with the user report there. We've also got quite a few questions that you know, people are asking and thinking about. So just to point out that please come and ask your questions on Moodle.org in the community forums, because we'd be more than happy to discuss them. And other fans or non-fans of the Moodle Gradebook would be happy to discuss them there as well. So if there's something that we can't cover in this webinar, well, actually, you've made a course, haven't you? We need to promote that. So there will be a discussion forum within the course on Moodle Academy
too. There is indeed.
Yeah, please, please do the course. I'm going to do it myself to learn more about the gradebook. Okay. So Martina is saying, I never changed the view. I didn't know. Thanks for sharing. And Tina's saying that there is a default view set by the administrator, but you know, it's, you can edit this to fit in with the teacher and the course. Kat says we don't edit the user report, but it's something we're looking to enhance in this academic year. And Doug replies sensibly that he tries to keep things as simple as possible in the student view.
Yep.
Thanks, Helen, for pointing out the gradebook forum in Moodle in English. So you've got a dedicated gradebook course on Academy and the general gradebook forum in Moodle in English.
Yep. Join them both so you can get more help and inputs from experts and peer experts, basically. Well, I'm not sure what's your mood right now, but here we are, where it's the end. And please feel free to ask any questions if you have. Now it's the right time.
Are there any more questions in the last couple of minutes? We've got people starting thanking you, Anna. Great session. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Please and do the course.
Yeah, and contributing. Thank you for sharing all these great ideas. Well, I don't want to promise much, but it feels that we haven't covered enough things, but it's a start.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's so much in the gradebook. And yeah, there are certain things that we didn't have time for, but it will be, you know, it's been an excellent introduction.
Perhaps it's worth mention that in some not far away from today, that this course will be combined with other assessment courses in the academy to form the assessment program. So you might be interested to get a program, get a certificate for a certificate of completion from Moodle Academy on assessment.
Indeed, yes. And Hiroshini was asking about rubrics as well. Do you have a session on rubrics? Maybe at some point next year, it would have to be next year, maybe we should do a follow-up gradebook session on other aspects of the gradebook, sort of gradebook level
yep.
two.
You can definitely find information about grading rubrics in the other two courses, the assessment exploring forums and assessment exploring assignments,
yes,
where the rubrics are mentioned. But yeah, we could have a full session just for that, indeed.
Okay, thanks, Anna.
So we are ready, I think, to wrap up. Thank you so much for your for being here and for your contribution. I hope you have enjoyed the session, and we would love you to consider getting involved further and help us grow by contributing to the development of Moodle Academy. You can do this by visiting the Get Involved course, which you will find on the front page of the Moodle Academy site. You can suggest ideas for new webinars and courses, and you can vote on ideas that have been suggested by others already. We are always on the lookout for community members to help present webinars and co-create short online courses. And we would love you help making Moodle Academy more inclusive too. So if you are able to, please jump into our Translate Moodle Academy course and get started with helping us translate our courses and webinars into other languages. And of course, please help spread the word about Moodle Academy by telling your colleagues about the courses we offer and the events we run. When you complete a course, you will earn a badge. Educators might like to think about getting involved with the Moodle Educator Certificate by taking the Are You Ready for the MEC quiz? And one of our certified service providers will support you through the certification process. Now, thank you for joining us today. I hope you found this useful, and I hope to see you on another Moodle Academy course, forum, or upcoming webinars. If you have any further questions, you can write them in the discussion forum affiliated with this course.
Thanks, Anna.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Goodbye.